Is bertralimab being developed as a single agent? Is it amenable to combination? And what kind of intent is it with the clinical trials? Is it curative intent, controlling the disease, improving the quality of life? Probably is certainly one of the aspects that you're looking at.
That's a very good question. So first of all, in terms of combination, you know, combination in treatment of inflammatory disease are going to be useful, like in oncology. Mm-hmm. So there's a disease that we're not targeting, at least you know for now, which is asthma, and particularly severe asthma. So it's been shown that attacking the eosinophils through interleukin 5 and through eotaxin 1 is a complementary, potentially synergistic approach to controlling the symptoms of the disease. So I think on a case-by-case basis, we'll look at that. But right now, we have to be singly, you know, focused on, you know, getting clinical data in 2016 in those two main indications of bullous pemphigoid and ulcerative colitis. So in bullous pemphigoid, currently the mainstay of treatment is high-dose oral steroids like prednisone, and many physicians use as much as 60 milligrams of oral prednisone for as much as 6 months or a year. And you can imagine that, you know, in patients that on average are, you know, 70 years old, that's, you know, very challenging for their overall health. So you do control the symptoms. You get relapses as soon as you stop, you know, the steroids. So what is our approach? You know, our approach is that starting with a lower dose of steroids, 30 milligram, plus bertralimab to show that we are controlling the symptoms. And as soon as we start controlling the symptoms, which may be as early as, you know, 1 or 2 weeks, or clearly in the first months, we're tapering down the steroids to under 10 milligrams. So we control the symptoms and we're able to rapidly taper the low dose of steroids. You know, that's a big advance for patients with bullous pemphigoid. And in fact, you know, it's always important for me to think about the patient. And we didn't know about bullous pemphigoid. It's really the patient advocacy group, the IPPF, that came to us and say, you know, we've read in the scientific literature, our experts have read that you have a drug that targets eotaxin 1 and eotaxin 1 is prevalent in that disease. Can you talk to our physicians and consider doing a clinical trial? That's what we've done. We've done our homework with those KOLs. And it's interesting that our trial is only 10 to 15 patients. We received an IND to do the phase 2 trial in the US in November. And every week we get a new center that says we would like to participate in this trial. So we may have as many as 10 centers in the US and outside of the US for that trial. Maybe not everybody will get an opportunity to get patients in the trial. That's very important also in the way we're developing drugs, is that strong science translated into the clinic, making sure that you have the right protocol, because very often, you know, to your question, John, you know, earlier, you do the wrong trial in the wrong indication or with the wrong patients, and you have disappointing results. It doesn't mean that the drug, you know, doesn't work. It just means that you didn't do the right, you know, clinical development. So making sure you have the right protocol, the right centers, and the right patients, and that you can enroll, you know, quickly enough. We get questions from investors all the time is, are you going to complete your trial by May, by June, by December? We don't know, but we're doing everything possible to complete the trials as quickly as possible. With quality, you know, quality centers and quality patients, so that we can have a clear readout of where we're going.